classification of flaps, we now move on to techniques for pocket elimination or reduction, in which we will cover the original Widman, Newman, modified Widman, undisplaced flap, apically displaced and modified the MARF, that is modified apically displaced flap, flaps for regenerative surgery, papilla preservation and its modifications, the conventional flap, distal molar surgeries, single flap approach, microsurgical approach, laser-assisted flap surgeries. So now with an array of so many, you know, techniques in our pocket, it's prudent to think over at, or in the beginning, it's normal to, you know, probably under get confused over which is the right technique of choice. So, and when you are all in your exams also asked to justify something as simple as this, that why are you doing this particular technique? I find a lot of postgraduates fumble. So here I would like to, you know, bring one very important aspect, and that is something that I mentioned a little while ago, and that is there is no straightforward recipe. Very few cases would be, you know, classic indications for a particular technique. You will have to understand the three critical zones, and so they are the soft tissue defects, the heart tissue, the nature of the heart tissue defects in your area of concern, and the teeth. So the tooth surface or the morphology of the tooth per se, as well as keep in mind the position of the gingival margin, attachment levels, crest of the alveolar bone, know where your mucogingival junction is, and the width of attached gingiva. So all of these parameters will probably dictate the nature of periodontal surgery that you need to perform. So you need to plan your surgeries well in advance, diagnose your condition, know which objective is going to be your mainstay, and then plan your surgery. So more often than not, you know, it is mostly a combination of a couple of one or two surgeries that you may have to do in a particular quadrant to achieve a successful outcome. So with this, we will look into each of the flap techniques in detail. The original Widman flap was described in detail by Leonard Widman, in the year 1918, when he wrote an article on treatment of pyorrhea alveolaris. So he essentially described full thickness mucoperiosteal flaps aimed at removing pocket epithelium and the inflamed connective tissue. So what he described was gingival incisions that covered up or included removal of the inflamed connective tissue, and there were two releasing vertical incisions, which were not necessarily, probably mid-buccal, they were taken as mid-buccal incisions, and then they were reflected in order to gain about 2 to 3 millimeters of exposure of bone. Bone recontouring was done, all the infected granulation tissue was removed, and the flaps, when they were approximated and sutured, they were very close to the level of bone, because back then he thought that that would lead to the least amount of depths of probing pockets in the past. So what are the advantages? It facilitated optimal cleaning of root surfaces, less discomfort as compared to gingivectomy, as healing occurred by primary indention, and his objective was also to reestablish a proper contour of the alveolar bone. Newman followed the original Widman, and he described intracrevicular incision with full thickness flap reflection. Mind you, both these techniques were with an objective for pocket elimination. So sectional releasing incisions were made, flap reflected, granulated, the granulation tissue and the pocket epithelium along with the root surfaces were debrided, irregular alveolar bony contour was corrected, flaps were trimmed and replaced at the crest of alveolar bone. Kirkland in 1931, he proposed the modified flap operation. And here then he, so this was a pocket reduction technique. So here he stressed on, trying to maintain as much of the tissue as possible. So minimal tissue resection. So an intracrevicular incision was something that he proposed. The gingiva is then retracted to expose the diseased root surface. Exposed root surfaces were subjected to mechanical debridement, and the flaps were repositioned and sutured. So it particularly helped in areas of anterior, in the anterior region, area aesthetic concern, as minimal gingival recession was expected, and it also helped in areas where we wanted to do some amount of regeneration. Then came up the modified Whitman flaps. So Mori, in 1965, he gave the term that is unrepositioned mucoperiosteal flap. And Ramford and Nissel in 1974, they coined and described in detail the modified Whitman flap, also known as the open flap technique or the open flap curettage technique. So the technique begins with initial incision at the margin, which is 0.5 to 1 mm away from the gingival margin, and normally performed with a blade 11 or a 15C blade. Elevation of the flap and the sulcular or the intracrevicular incision, which is made from the depth of the pocket to the alveolar crest. Now here, in areas of aesthetic concern, we could skip the internal bevel and directly take intracrevicular incision. Also, when the buccal pockets are less than 2 millimeters, you need to follow the same. So having said that, a third incision is then made. It could be an Ortman's knife could be used, and perpendicular to the long axis of the tooth. And this is to remove the V-shaped bitch, following which the flaps are carefully, open flap debridement is done, the root surfaces are cleaned, granulation tissue is removed, calculus if anything, if remaining is flaked, calculus are removed, and the flaps are then carefully adjusted and over the alveolar bone and sutured interproximally. So now here, complete coverage in the interdental areas, because we want healing by primary intention is a necessity that you need to observe. And if that is not happening, only then you may have to do some amount of osteoplasty in order to allow for close adaptation of the flap to the tooth surface. So here in the original articles, they majorly, so sutures and suturing techniques also becomes like a different topic to discuss. But the sutures that they recommended were the continuous sling sutures approximating the labial or the buccal flap and the palatal flaps or the lingual flaps. So this is where the classic internal bevel followed by the crevicular, interdental, debridement and suturing. So which is why the modified Whitman flap became a very popular flap, a flap that is that we still perform in our in the practice. And so what was the now this is an important question that some of us want to always ask is what were the modifications of the Whitman flap that the modified flap encompassed. So Whitman flap was originally a pocket elimination procedure, while this remained a pocket reduction procedure. The first incision for the Whitman was about 1 to 2 mm from the gingival margin, and we wanted to be more conservative. So the first incision was slightly more closer, about 0.5 to 1 mm from the gingival margin. Apical displacement of the flap was a norm in the original Whitman for pocket elimination, while in the modified Whitman, so we don't have vertical releasing incisions, so no apical displacement of the flap. And of course, osseous recontouring was a must with the original Whitman, while in the modified Whitman, we limited it to situations where flap approximation was not adequate. So with this, one moment. Yeah. So the next technique that